Welcome to the newest RV interviews. We're here at RAGT 17, and I'm super excited because we have the absolutely amazing and beautiful and, of course, ungodly talented J.R. Ward with her newest book, The Chosen, with that incredibly gorgeous cover. Do you love the cover?
Well, actually, when they first emailed it to me, I wasn't a big fan. But then when I saw it in person on the book, I fell in love with it.
Oh, I think it's really powerful. And all the readers here have been talking about how much they love it. So how involved are you with the artwork?
I'm not.
You're not? You're just writing the story? And
well, I mean, I have a visceral response. I like something or I don't like something. Mm-hmm. But the covers really are a marketing tool.
Right, exactly.
And that's their purpose. Mm-hmm. Like, my job is to put words in between the cover, right, that excite and enervate readers, and their job is to put something on the cover that, you know, creates attention. So I prefer to work in situations where everyone is an expert at whatever job they're doing.
See, I think that makes perfect sense. I know sometimes we don't like the covers, but they know what has already been on, so it doesn't look too similar, you know, what works for you, what your readers' expectations are. So yeah, they're experts. They know what's going on with it. Well, I always love to talk about the covers, but we're doing something a little different with this RV interview because you're so popular. Readers have been in your line since 11:30 this morning, and the signing isn't until 3 o'clock. So since not everybody will have a chance to really talk to you much, we took questions from some of the readers. So I'm going to shoot some of those at
you. I'm ready.
And I hope I do them justice because they were nervous. I'm like, oh, ask her. So I hope I get this correct. So they want to know, do you have a time frame in mind for how many more books will be in the Black Dagger Brotherhood? Or do you see an ending, or do you think you're just going to keep building now that the younger generations are starting to mature?
I don't see that. It is a completely open-ended series at this
point. Oh, good.
So as long as readers still want them and the good Lord keeps me up above ground, I'm in. One of the things that's interesting about the B2B world is it just keeps evolving on its own. Mm-hmm. So there are many more incarnations of what things look like in Caldwell that I can see way out in the future. So I love
that. That was going to be my next question. Yeah. So you've already got some ideas that are percolating.
Not ideas. I don't think anything up. I'm actually not all that bright. It's what the story tells me where mm-hmm. it's going to go.
Right.
And I just record it. So I have pictures in my head.
So you can see them that far in advance.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Very fun. Readers will be thrilled to hear that. And then with the Bourbon King series, you have a new book coming out in August, The Devil's Cut, and they want to know, are you enjoying the deception and family drama in the Bradford family?
Yes, because
I
love it. I am an old diehard Dynasty fan.
Oh, yeah.
And so to some degree, although I don't tend to draw from real life, again, the stories are what they are, the Bourbon Kings is really a melding between my love of my adopted state of Kentucky and then my fanship of Dynasty and... Yeah. You know, I always wanted to be Alexis Carrington Colby when I grew up.
I think everybody did.
Yeah, right?
That's
the blonde
awesome.
Version.
Yeah, that's terrific.
Although you'd figure because I'm blonde, I would go for Crystal, but no, I wanted to be the B-I-T-C-H.
That makes sense. Yeah, well, that makes sense. Not that you would want to be that.
No, just because it's more fun.
Like, right, that's what I'm saying, yeah.
Right, in real life, I'm a real good girl and a rule abider.
Yeah,
and
you're
I think
a
there's
beautiful,
this alter,
lovely person, yeah.
Yeah, my alter ego, there's a real see you next Tuesday.
Yeah. Okay, so the other question is, I love that was perfect. It's amazing at the end of the day, whether to be your paranormal books or even your contemporary, there seems to be a strong sense of community and family. So for you, is that the core of the books, the community and the family? Does that seem to be where your heart is with the books? Do you think that far into it?
No, my heart is irrelevant. My job is to do the stories justice and to get them on paper. Mm-hmm. I will say that tight family bonds raise the stakes in any conflict. That environment provides opportunity for conflict and growth with people.
Right.
You know, in our own families, I mean, you know, there are always opportunities to grow and learn things about yourself and learn things about people and stuff. And so I really feel like the stories in my head tend towards those environments because it is a great source of stability and it is greatly threatened by instability.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean?
Oh,
and
yeah.
So but again, because I don't have any control over anything, you know, and I don't believe my heart is irrelevant. What I want is irrelevant. My job is to engage people with what I'm shown in my head, you know?
And to get it out of your
to
head
get
onto
it
the
out,
paper.
Keep moving.
Right. And in your books, it's not always actual blood family. Sometimes family consists of the people you in real life that you make a family.
Well, and that's a real, that is a parallel for me, is obviously I have my blooded family, but I have incredibly close relationships with lots of people that I consider my family, even if I didn't grow up with them and they're not blood.
Yeah, they become that.
Absolutely.
Right. Well, that seems to be a very prevalent in your books. In the Black Dagger Brotherhood series, you wrote second stories for past characters in The King and the Beast. Do you like revisiting characters? And I know you're going to say it's not up to you.
Yeah, no.
Not just referencing them in a series in someone else's book, but being able to write a whole new story, like for Wrath and Beth and the King and Rage and Mary and the Beast.
Well, so one of the good news and the bad news of having no control over your stories is that when I finish a book and it's done, that's great. But see, everyone who's in here, they're still going. Mm-hmm. And so as I watch them continually evolve in my head, even if I'm not putting them down to page for production, every once in a while I get to a point where I look at where they are and I'm like, oh, you know, people have got to know this. This is really interesting, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like my relationship with my readers, I always picture us sort of as one giant sort of coffee shop, and like everyone's talking about, sort of gossiping about the same world, you know? Mm-hmm. And then I get to be the one who goes, oh my God, you're never going to believe what, you know, fill in the blank here happened. So I like to update people with where the happily ever afters are evolving. And
I'm sure readers love that. I'll get reader comments every so often. They'll say, what are these characters up to now? And I'm like, well, the book ended, so, you know, they're just living their happily ever after. But sometimes it spurs me into thinking more about it, because I do tend to think that they're still going on, as you just said. So it'll, but unlike you, I plot a little bit in my head, not on paper.
Oh, I plot on paper.
See, I don't plot on paper. I just, by the seat of my pants. Oh, once you decide to write it, then you plot on paper.
Well, no, so the way it works for me is I record on paper the major scenes that I'm shown. Mm-hmm. And so for me, the challenge for outlining is, do I get them in the correct chronological order? And which POV is going to show what's really going on best? Mm-hmm. But yeah, so it's this weird balance. Because like I've tried to control things before, because I'm an incredibly disciplined, like psychotic control freak. Which is just, it's the irony of irony that like I spend most of my life being out of control in these books,
right.
You know? But I feel like I have to have those bench marks on paper so I know where I stand before I start typing. Mm-hmm. And then usually it's the last 10% that I have no idea that I don't anticipate, that's the best part of every book.
See, I think it's fascinating. It seems like every author does it
differently
in their own unique
yeah.
way. I
yeah.
did a thing one time where I asked Jane Ann Krentz and Elizabeth Lowell and Susan, and it was like everybody had a slightly different answer for how they construct their stories and what their process is.
And it's all the right answer.
Like when it's whatever works
yes,
for the author.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
And for any readers listening, POV is point of view.
Oh,
so,
sorry, forgive me. Yeah.
But no, I mean, I totally got it, but if I can just see readers are going to write me and go, what's POV? So it's point of view for whichever of your characters is dominant in the scene at that point. Okay, so are there any new series avenues you'd like to go in, or are you very content right now with the Black Dagger Brotherhood and the Bourbon?
I have thought up a major new series.
Ooh, breaking
yeah,
news.
No, well, not quite, because I'm not allowed to say anything yet, but hopefully I'll have an announcement soon.
Oh, that's awesome. Now, will you do that at one of your launch parties, you think, or will you announce it before that?
I don't know. It depends on when I'm allowed to say something. It's mm-hmm. not the kind of thing that I'm going to be sitting on. Like, as soon as I'm able to, I'm going to talk about it, because I'm really bad at keeping secrets. Like, don't ever tell me if you plan a surprise party
okay.
for anyone, because I will be the
so
idiot who blows
pregnant.
It.
Don't yeah. tell anyone. No, thank God that's not going to happen. So you do one launch party mm-hmm. a year?
Yeah.
And you get people from everywhere for that.
I'm so lucky. I mean, because my thing is I'd rather be at home writing. That's my job, you know? Mm-hmm. So I'm very lucky that people come. But that's why we choose Cincinnati, is because it's got a big airport and people can come in here, you know, more easily from other parts.
Well, knowing that you only do that one makes me extra flattered that you'll come to this little event that we have. And I think readers are just going out of their minds in there. So I think that wraps it up for our reader
Great.
Questions. Thank you so
Thank
very
you,
much.
Lori.
I can't tell you how much we appreciate it.
Thank you.